Hi there, I am Nadzia Bernstick. I am Métis Francophone. I am from this area. My grandmother is Simone Riel. I was very close to her and I miss her dearly. Her great-grandfather was Alexandre Riel, who was the first president of the Métis Historical Society. Those are my ancestors and I'm proud of where I'm from. And this is...
I'm Jason Bernstick. I am from the Cree Nation from Alberta. A little place called Paul Band, Duffield Reserve. My mother is from Alexander. My father's side of the family is from Alexis Reserve, also in Alberta. But I'm not from here. But I it's very similar to where I grew up. It's very, very, very similar.
We're in a town called St. Claude, in Manitoba, Canada. This is just on the outskirts of the town. There's a wildlife sanctuary here, and we thought it would be really great to come out here for this conversation about climate change.
I moved from Alberta when I was about 18 into BC, and one of the things that I noticed right away was the forest industry. They were doing a lot of clear cutting. There was a lot of protests around that. And I kind of looked into it and did a bit of research and educated myself, I guess, as best as I could. But I was finding that it was like, and you could see it actually too when you fly over them in planes, some of the mountains where they clear cut, because they're not recovering the same, or, but they're just kind of, what's happening is that the snow lands and it melts a lot quicker, runs down the mountain a lot faster, and just doesn't have time to sit there and nourish the earth as it used to. And even if we're planting trees, you know, those patches over the mountains, they speak for themselves. And it's kind of like creating those environments and those conditions for, let's say that when we have forest fires, what happens next, you know? So I think we saw that this year in particular with the air quality, even in Winnipeg and throughout Canada, like you go outside and it's just like, it's smoky. You could smell it. You could smell it inside the house, never mind. And it's just a reminder of how, like, you know, our air quality, just the air that we breathe, how precious that is. And we need to take care of that stuff. So how do we do that, I guess, is the question.
Now that we have a sun, I feel like it makes it so much more specific to that. Like, what are we leaving our future generations? And I know for me, it's like every action is for him. So and so what does that mean? What does that mean for him to be able to survive and for his children and his grandchildren to survive and have a beautiful life and a healthy life? What do we have to do? So I don't know if I have a message, but I think that we can't forget about those generations. And I think that whatever we're doing now is going to affect all of those generations to come. Everything is for him now. And so I think that makes it really important.
We came out here because we wanted to be closer to, like, quiet and closer to the land. And have like a safe place for our son where he can grow up and running around in a bush and playing with sticks and rocks. And,
you know, not everyone can just move out to a beautiful, like, safe space. And even here, I've noticed, like, since I was little, things that have changed because of climate change, like things that are a little bit different. I've noticed the wildlife that we didn't used to see in the town. We used to really, there was a lot more bush and a lot more, and animals and wildlife used to stay there. And so we didn't really see that in town. Whereas now, literally in our backyard, we'll have like a flock of wild geese that come into town just this morning.
Yeah.
This summer we had a drought here in Manitoba and it was very hot. I feel hotter than past summers. We had no water. We were fortunate to have drinking water where we are.
Yeah.
As you know, some lands
We're still in kind of a bit of a water crisis here now. We're level 3 right now, I think. So that's like, we have to be really, really mindful on how much water we use. So that's an eye opener for me and a reminder. It's like, holy smokes.
Like, I remember when I was little, we would be outside all the time and sunscreen wasn't even like discussed. Like, we barely wore sunscreen, or if we did, it was like number 5 or whatever. Like, it was very, very low. Like, you have to be slathering that stuff on all the time. I can't even go out in the sun anymore. It is different. The heat is different.
Yeah, I never wore sunscreen as a kid. I don't even think I knew what sunscreen was as a kid. I just went outside and did my thing, so yeah. But I have noticed, like, when we're outside, it's like, wow, I actually burn. And over the past 10 years, I've been burning.
I think one thing that kind of, I know that scares me is when I look at the overwhelming, like when I look at the whole situation, it becomes very overwhelming. And I think it's easy to just block it out and be like, oh, forget it. I just don't want to think about that. I'm just going to go on with my life. But I think that if we do, because we have so much to learn. And I think that if we just do one thing every day, it becomes so much simpler and it becomes doable and it does make a difference. And I think that that's where I have to remind myself of that, that the one thing I do in that day makes a difference and will make a difference for my son. And I think that's how we change.
It's time that, you know, enough of this. Like, I think we really need to step up and get ourselves educated and look into this thing and take it serious, because it is serious.
Hey, bonjour Annie. Je suis Justine Pambrun. Je viens du cœur du Nord-Amérique, qui est Manitoba. Et la rivière aux Prunes, qu'on appelle Saint-Jean-Baptiste, et où est-ce que je viens de. On parle aujourd'hui sur le changement de climat. Puis il n'y a certainement pas de frontière avec le changement de climat. Nous nous considérons comme partie de la Terre. Nous sommes liés à la Terre et c'est où nous venons et ce qui nous sommes. On est 5 générations de mes ancêtres qui ont travaillé la terre le long de la rivière Rouge. On a cultivé mes grands-pères, mon arrière-grand-père, mon père, ont cultivé, labouré avec des chevaux, avec une harse à 6 panneaux et le battage avec des racks à foin. Mon grand-père avait 17 chevaux. L'engrais qu'il mettait dans la terre, c'était le trèfle. Il faisait des rotations de récolte aussi, puis il séparait, c'était toujours pour les faire certain qu'on on pensera toujours à la génération à venir. Fait que la manière qu'il faisait les choses, c'était toujours faire certain de prendre soin de la mère terre. Fait que je pense qu'on a eu toujours un grand respect pour Aki, la mère terre, pour Nibi, pour l'eau, pour nous donner l'air et puis escauder le feu. La raison d'être, c'est que c'est parce qu'on vivait direct là, puis on savait que c'était nos ressources. On savait le danger de les grandes pluies, des tonnerres, la grêle, les tornades, et comment l'eau pouvait changer de la rivière Rouge avec des grosses inondations, et aussi le feu quand on brûlait les champs dans ce temps-là pour renouveler la terre. C'est là que la fertilisation artificielle a rentré et le pesticide. Et donc, de 1965 en 1980, c'est là que j'ai remarqué qu'il y avait moins d'abeilles. On n'entendait plus les grenouilles chanter dans les calvettes. On n'entendait plus les criquets. Il fallait fermer toutes les fenêtres à chaque fois qu'il allait dans les champs pour mettre ces pesticides-là, puis on se questionnait qu'est-ce qu'ils sont en train de mettre sur notre manger. En fait, le changement climatique qu'on a remarqué, si je regarde, nous autres, nos histoires étaient toutes orales. C'est comme ça qu'on apprenait en faisant les choses, puis à écouter les histoires de nos arrière-grands-parents à travers de nos grands-parents et nos parents. Et puis, on connaissait que ça, que c'était pour avoir des inondations. On l'a vécu nous autres-mêmes. Et la sécheresse aussi. Mais qu'est-ce qu'on remarque, c'est que les derniers, peut-être, comme je regarde, j'ai 60 ans, les derniers 40 ans, on dirait qu'il y a plus de variations, plus souvent, plus des tempêtes qui sont plus sévères, des pluies ou la grêle, les tornades. Et pour prédire comment... Le fait qu'on a vécu ça, puis que moi, j'ai appris beaucoup de mon père, il pouvait dire quand il t'apporait de la pluie. Puis je disais, « Comment tu peux dire ça? Je ne vois rien, je ne vois même pas un nuage. » Il pouvait le sentir. Il dit, « Respire, tu tu sens l'air. L'air est différent. Puis il nous enseignait tout de cette manière-là pour vraiment comprendre comment faire. Pareil comme ma grand-mère qui a enseigné comment planter dans les jardins puis mettre le restant de ton manger, le compost, la verdure dans le jardin. Mais aussi, comme cette année, on a eu de la grosse sécheresse. Sécheresse au point que tous mes légumes que vous voyez ici, ordinairement, ça devrait être trois fois plus gros que ça devrait être. Puis, ordinairement, mes barils d'eau, je prends de l'eau qui me coule dessus mon toit, j'en ai pas eu presque cette année. Je suis chanceuse si j'ai eu 5 barils durant tout du printemps à l'automne. Fait que je me sers un peu d'eau de chez moi pour supporter les légumes, mais on voit que ça fonctionne pas aussi bien. Comme ça, c'est trois fois plus gros. Tout ça, c'est tout plus petit. Mais même le sauge, parce que notre monde, il y en a plus qui commencent à passer à travers leur guérison. Et puis, on a besoin plus de les médecines qui viennent de... les médecines qui sont importantes, comme le sauge. Et le sauge, cette année, il a grandi juste de cette grandeur-là. Puis ordinairement, le sauge va être ça de grand. Fait qu'avec ça, c'est un problème parce que... Qu'est-ce qui est le problème? C'est qu'il n'a pas grandi gros, fait que tu en as moins à partager. Mais aussi, la grosse chaleur qui est arrivée très tôt, ça monte en graines. Puis une fois que ça monte en graines, la graine tombe à terre, mais on n'a pas de pluie. Fait que la graine, elle sèche. Fait qu'on n'aura pas d'autres productions. Puis si on la coupe trop courte, comme vous voyez, celui-là, il a probablement été coupé juste direct en bas. Il faut en laisser au moins un tiers pour que ça continue à se reproduire l'année prochaine. Il y a une meilleure chance avec les gros hivers durs. Fait que c'est certainement un défi, le changement de climat. Fait que c'est à nous de vraiment tout prendre une responsabilité, de respecter la mère Terre et de commencer à l'écouter et de demander... Hey, ben, qu'est-ce que toi t'as besoin à place de juste prendre?
Tantôt toya kakyo nitiwagana niwakuma kantek kakyo auyak. My name niya Winston Watani Kehe Watani. That means the young spotted eagle tail feather. And the name Winston comes from Winston Churchill. I was born in 1940, and when Winston Churchill told the people, if we do not get America into this fight, we're going to be speaking German pretty fast here. So I'm really thankful to the Prime Minister of England for getting the Americans and the Canadians into that battle over there. And I'm really thankful to my people because Kitteskino, this is our beautiful land. When we say that Kitteskino, our land understands that we had more Indian people fighting in both those wars than any other race of people. Why? Because Kitteskino, this is our beautiful land. I grew up on Red Pheasant and I lived out there, and everybody in Nihyo-Itik, everybody spoke Cree. And many times, everybody was on horseback, and my old Auntie Sarah Fun heard a horse outside galloping towards her house. And I was sitting there having a cup of tea with her, and she said, "Oh, Frank, I bet you asked." That's Frank coming. She knew the sound of his horse, the way that he ran his horse. And so they had their ears attuned to the sounds of nature. It was really beautiful, because anytime nature spoke to you, you listened to nature. You didn't necessarily listen to mankind, but when nature spoke, you always listened. And sometimes nature would speak a little bit early in the winter. Like if you're a little bit out in the country, sometimes you'd hear crack, it'd be like a gunshot like that, and a tree would split right in half. It was so cold. But in those days, freezing your hands was not unusual. It was easy to freeze your fingers. If you didn't have good gloves, you could freeze your fingers. You were always freezing your heel or your toes or something. And I remember sometimes there when in the 50s and in the 60s, one time I got to the airport in Winnipeg, and there's a 3-minute warning. You only had 3 minutes to be outside, and if you were outside any longer than that, your face would start to freeze, and you're aware of that. So I had an Arctic parka, and it had wolverine fur around here. Wolverine fur doesn't freeze, and neither does it steam up like that. And it would just come like that, so it'd be about this much showing of my face, which was just enough to, and then I'd walk and I'd look like that. And I could see. But sometimes the winter was nice. And if that owl came down, let's say if he came down about October, then we all knew that it was going to be a rough winter, cold. And if the horses had really thick fur, we knew it was going to be a rough winter. If the geese, I remember there sometimes in the fall, looking at the geese from the west to the east. They started in the west as far as you could see, and they were going just flying like that. Thousands and thousands and thousands of geese and ducks flying over there like that. And Dad would say, son, you better get a lot of wood cut. It's going to be a rough winter. All the tricks with the birds heading south early, you know it's going to be a cold winter. And here now, for instance, I saw the birds heading north, the geese, quite a few times I've seen them heading north, even now, and west, big flocks heading north and west. Tell my wife, not sure what's going to be going on here this winter, but it doesn't look like it's going to be a really cold winter, because, you know, and when spring started, this year started really early. Like all of a sudden, there we were in the sunshine, and it was a beautiful, you know, and the winter was very easy. We might have another one like that again, you know. So I'm not saying that's a good thing, because that's climate change. And when you get climate change, you have, when for instance, like it's when we've known about this for a long time, is that the exhaust from the automobiles in cities, there's so much of that, and it creates something in the atmosphere, which is not good. And they even said that even cows flatulating is not good, because that gets stored. And everything gets stored, everything bad that we do, it gets stored in the atmosphere, and it has lots of repercussions. And the glaciers, and that happening, and everything is getting warmer, and that's not good. This project that is going on, climate change, is a big project. And what they're saying is, we don't have much time. And that's a sad part of it. People have to become aware of exactly what's going on and what they're doing.
Oh my, oh my, oh my. Come.